Operation Officer for the Incident Management Team down here in Dakota Dunes. As always, we'd like to start off with a few comments from Governor Dennis Dugard. Governor?
Good morning, and thank you, everyone, for being here as part of this news conference. It is, I can't state enough, it is vital that the public in South Dakota be informed of the constantly changing river situation, and it is the media that participates in situations like this that make that possible for us. So thank you for being the connection between the governments and their constituents. Last night, I know that we made good progress on the levees in the large communities who are most affected by the flood event. I walked the levees in Pier and Fort Pier at 5:30 and 6:30 this morning, and the contractor is continuing to make very good progress and working through the night and all day long. And the levees in Pier and Fort Pier continue to shape up well. I also will be walking the levee in the Dakota Dunes community after this press conference. I want to take this opportunity while I'm here to say a special thank you again to Jeff Dooley, Dennis Melstead, and the other community leaders, Don Fuchsa, and others who, because they saw a difficulty coming for their citizens, they acted in some cases without full information. They knew they needed to begin action. And then as the levels to which the water would rise became more clear, they then knew what task they had before them. But the importance here is that they began immediately. And I can't say enough how important that has been to making our success more likely. The water levels are the next topic I want to address. The water release schedule at Oahe remains as was earlier offered by the Corps. The release from Oahe increased this morning. The release will remain stable at Gavin's Point. Again, both of those were scheduled and are proceeding as scheduled. Weather has been good. We had some locally isolated rain events of relatively small magnitude that have not impacted the release schedule. We are very fortunate we've had no widespread major rain events that would impact the release schedule, nor have we had locally concentrated rain events that impeded levee progress. So on both counts, we've been fortunate that the weather has treated us well in the last day or two. Evacuation plans are proceeding. Pier and Fort Pier evacuation is largely complete. I'm sure the mayors will visit that subject, but I know that the Pier Fort Pier evacuation, which was announced Wednesday evening, proceeded very well. And I saw myself the houses that have been marked as fully evacuated and closed and buttoned up, if you will. And I know that teams in Pier and Fort Pier continue to evaluate that and work their way through that community again and again to continue to maintain their current information about who is evacuated and who has chosen to assume the risk of staying. In the dunes, a press release went out to indicate that evacuation recommendation, to reemphasize that evacuation recommendation this morning. The evacuation includes all homes in the Country Club area, and that applies to all Dakota Dunes residents whose homes are on Monterey Trail, East and West Pinehurst Trail, Doral Lane, and La Costa Lane, as well as all homes south of those streets. The evacuation request does not apply to the areas known as the Meadows and the Prairie at this time. This is not a mandatory evacuation, but teams of law enforcement and National Guard are going house to house in the area where evacuation is recommended to be sure that those residents who choose to stay fully understand what they are up against. They fully understand that the risk presented by the water goes up as the water goes up. They also should understand that utilities would become less and less available and ultimately, possibly and likely unavailable. And also the construction of the levees will increasingly restrict their ability to move and ultimately will disallow vehicle traffic out of some of these areas. They simply will not be able to get out because of the levees in the way. So we've asked that those residents who did not choose to abide by the request to evacuate by the end of Thursday make every effort now, being more fully informed of the risk, that if they are going to evacuate, they do so by midnight tonight. Then we will again work through the area with our teams to be sure we know where the houses are evacuated and where the citizens have chosen to stay and have burdened the emergency responders with this additional risk that those residents present. National Guard, Christy, do you have information on the National Guard or shall I present it?
You can go ahead, Governor.
All right, an update on the National Guard. In the Pier, Fort Pier area, the last two nights, we've been using the National Guard to conduct mobile security patrols on the levees in Pier and Fort Pier to ensure the safety of the locals as levee construction is completed. The National Guard has been meeting with local and state law enforcement to refine the levee security and surveillance plan. The Guard also met with local and state officials to develop the concept and procedures for conducting quick emergency levee repair operations. They'll be meeting again to complete that plan. Today's operation in the Pier Fort Pier area of Guardsmen, approximately 90 security personnel will begin security along the levee. About 335 personnel will fill and emplace sandbags in both communities. About 46 will be on alert for quick reaction, and 40 engineer personnel will be doing equipment maintenance and be prepared to conduct engineer operations. In the Dakota Dunes and Yankton area, we have 70 personnel, 59 of them from Yankton's Charlie Battery were relocated from Pier Fort Pier on the night of June 1st for sandbagging in Yankton yesterday. 75 personnel were mobilized yesterday from the 235th MP Company and the 153rd Engineer Battalion to help in the Dakota Dunes, 40 for sandbagging and 40 for these evacuation surveys. 125 personnel are being mobilized from the MP Company and the 114th Fighter Wing today, and they'll report to the task force I just described tomorrow. And today's operations will consist of about 250 Guard soldiers sandbagging in the dunes, another 70 sandbagging in Yankton or providing sandbags to other areas, 50 personnel providing security and assisting evacuations. That's sort of the global perspective for the state, and I'll stand by later for other questions.
Thank you, Governor. At this time, we'll turn it over to Terry Wooster at the Emergency Operations Center in Pier.
Thank you. Good morning. We'll go through the list here. I think we'll start with reports from the Corps of Engineers, Eric Stosch and Lee J. Templeton.
Okay, I'll start with Oahe report like we've always done in the past. Basically, I'm just going to talk about releases from Oahe. That's pretty much the update we have for the day. Releases from Oahe changed a little bit yesterday for today and tomorrow. The amount released did not change. The only thing we did was we changed and we took that 15,000 cubic feet per second increase and we took it in two stages. The first one at 8 o'clock in the morning, the second one at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We will do the same thing for the increases tomorrow. Again, we're taking that 20,000 cubic feet per second increase and we're breaking it down into 10,000 cubic feet per second at 8 o'clock in the morning and 10,000 cubic feet per second at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, the reason that we did this is just to make these rises a little more manageable, a little more gentle, if you will, to give people time to respond, to see what's going to happen. Previous to this, our increases were a maximum of 5,000 cubic feet per second. People in Omaha just thought that it'd be a little bit more conservative, a little bit better if we just broke those up into halves and do it over the course of the day, just to give people the time to respond and to see what was happening. Everything else about that schedule has remaining the same, and I'm referring to the overall daily increases. Those have not changed. Those are still the same. We're still going to the 150,000 cubic feet per second on Tuesday, June 7th. With that, I'll turn it over to Lee J.
I'll be covering information concerning the Gavin's Point project and some information concerning the Dakota Dunes levee build. Currently, the reservoir above the Gavin's Point Dam at midnight last night was at elevation 1206.34. There's no change to the release schedule. You can find information on the relief schedule and what you can anticipate for water elevations in locations on the Be Ready site that the state has. That information has been provided and has been posted for more accurate information on what we can expect for water elevations as the flow rates increase. Some information on the secondary levee in which the Corps of Engineers is currently in the process of constructing. It was awarded 2 days ago, late in the evening 2 days ago. Yesterday, sandbags were beginning to be filled in preparation to start the project. Today, surveying will be done. The alignment will be confirmed. More sandbags will be filled. A lot of the sections is pretty heavy in sandbags, so there's a lot of preparation on getting those filled and ready to go. In the next 24 hours, we expect the structure to start on the alignment that's been selected. With the use of HESCOs and sandbags, that should be completed by Tuesday, is the anticipated completion time for that secondary levee in the Dakota Dunes area. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. We should apologize to people. There are a lot of people traveling a lot of ways, and so if it seems like we're not totally going the way we are, we have people who can talk about the coordination of efforts at both sites, but I think it would be well to focus a little bit of attention on the communities affected, if that's all right with everybody. And I'd like to start up here with the two mayors from Pier and Fort Pier, and then throw it back down to Dakota Valley School. Can we start with Pier Mayor Lori Gill?
All right, evacuations in Pier. Voluntary evacuations are recommended and have been recommended in the flood zone, and many people have already left their homes at this time. Many have questions regarding how to prepare for the evacuation and what will happen during their absence. The City of Pier will maintain electrical service to the affected areas as long as possible. Sump pumps should be left running, but all other appliances should be disconnected, and we're recommending that you disconnect your water softeners as well as you're leaving your homes. Water service will be discontinued to the vacated homes. Sewage backflow is possible during flooding. Residents should take proper precautions to ensure that basement floor drains, bathtubs, and sinks are plugged. Law enforcement will create gated communities in the affected areas, and no unauthorized people will be allowed into the evacuated neighborhoods. That planning is going on as we speak to ensure safety and security for those that are leaving their homes. Sandbag operations. The demand for sandbags during the evening hours has dropped dramatically. So what we've done is we have a large supply of sandbags available at the bailing facility and the Georgia Morris Middle School. So if people still decide that they need more sandbags, you can go and get them there. We will continue our daytime sandbagging operations until it's determined that we no longer need them. But that is going on right now, so you know you can get sandbags. Storm sewer. All storm water drains in the affected area have been plugged to prevent backflow into our streets. We will continue to monitor the system, and we ask residents to help us. If you notice water coming out of the storm sewer drains in the streets, please let City Hall know. Electrical. Lights on the river side of the levee have been taken offline. No problems have been reported at this time other than transformers and switches which were damaged during levee construction. We're getting those back online. Many residents have noticed that the city has not sandbagged its electrical transformers, and they're calling and asking about that. It is important that these transformers are not obstructed by sandbags, as they must be accessible to our city crews. So you will see transformers, they're designed to work the way that they are during flooding, and there will be no need at this time for sandbagging the transformers. Water. The wells on Laframboise Island have been shut down at this time. 7 additional wells have been secured and are operational. Our water supply is safe and is operating as expected. Wastewater. The wastewater treatment plant has bypass pumps that are in place, and the facility has been isolated from the river. The rising water table in Southeast Pier has already created some sewage backup problems. This was expected, and we will likely see more of it as the river rises. Residents in the flood zone should take precautions, once again, including to plug basement floor drains, seal basement fixtures, and restrict water use in the affected areas. That ends the peer report at this time.
Next, we'll hear from Port Pier Mayor Sam Tidball.
Well, we continue to get questions about moving out of homes in the areas that have potential for flooding. We believe that about 90% plus residents have moved or made arrangements, and most of the others have also made some plans to what to do in case they need to get out. So people should be aware that many of the areas where homes are located that are in that inundation area, that there probably will be some limited access to them. So we want to keep as many people out that don't have any business being there as possible. And everyone needs to be aware that the Corps is telling us that this high release of water will continue well into July or longer, depending on rainfall amounts. With the levees being completed, it is imperative that they be protected. Please stay off the levees. And if you see wildlife such as deer or burrowing animals on or near the levees, please report it, because they could damage the protective plastic and eventually cause failure of the levees. We do have a plan in place to take care of emergency leaks or breaks if possible, but we urge being very careful of that plastic protective covering. Also, if you observe water flowing out of storm drains, please report it as soon as possible. As Mayor Gill suggested, there are many things to do if you're moving out of your home, and I won't reiterate all those, but just pay attention to that. Residents have worked long and hard, and in many cases cooperatively, to protect their homes and businesses. The volunteers have been fantastic and very much appreciated, as well as the National Guard, the Highway Patrol, and the state and federal agencies. We are probably as well prepared as we can be, considering the short time frame we've had. Our utilities, water and sewer and electric, are relatively secure and will continue to be operated. Please be safe and don't take any unnecessary risks. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Tidball. That's it from community reports here. Nathan, do you have a community representative down there?
Yes, next we'll have Jeff Dooley, the manager of the Dakota Dunes Community Improvement District.
Good morning. We are continuing to secure our public infrastructure, which we believe is about 90% complete. We will be shutting down our water treatment plant either later today or tomorrow. And once we do that, we'll be getting our water through our secondary source with Sioux City, the city of Sioux City's water system. As the governor had mentioned, there is an evacuation area in Dakota Dunes. In that evacuation area, just so those folks know, we have a systematic plan to plug sanitary sewers to prevent them from inundating the rest of the system. We will keep the water mains in that area charged as long as we can, and what's appropriate. Now, as the work continues on the levee, we will continue to provide water and sewer service to the Prairie, the Meadows residential community, and also the commercial parks. We will do that through a water connection to Sioux City that I mentioned earlier, and also the sanitary sewer connection we have with them. For those who are leaving, as the governor said, once you leave, you can't come back. And I want the people to know who are leaving their homes that we will work with wherever we need to make sure that that area is secure and that you don't have to worry about your home from that standpoint. We will also, for those leaving, while you're away from your home, we will do whatever we can to provide you the information that we have so that you have a place to go. Maybe it'll be our website where you can go to get information in regards to what's going on in Dakota Dunes, both in the evacuation area and other places. So with that, I think I'll just turn back over.
Next, I think we'll go to Christy Terman at the Emergency Operations Center in Pierre.
Thanks. Briefly, we're continuing to operationally coordinate state resource requests and technical assistance to all the communities up and down the river that are being impacted by this event. There are considerable amounts of state personnel and state equipment that is assisting, and we are processing new resource requests all the time as they come in. We're also continuing to do advanced planning, particularly in the Pierre area, for levee security and patrol. We're working closely with local officials to identify needs that they may have and additional ideas for levee security and patrol. These ideas will be shared with the Dakota Dunes community when they get to this phase of their operation. And long term, we're looking to identify issues that all of these communities will be facing with having a long term displacement of their residents behind the levee. So we're taking a look at those issues, beginning to identify what they are and strategies to deal with them. And that's my report for today.
Thank you. Nathan, is it back to you?
Yes, next, I think we'll hear from Joe Lowe.
Joe Lowe, the incident commander for the Dakota Dunes Incident Management Team.
Thank you, Nathan. My name again is Joe Lowe. I'm the incident commander for Rocky Mountain Team C. Rocky Mountain Team C is a state-sponsored interagency Type 2 incident management team that is available for incidents of national significance, which we most certainly are having right now. Number one, I'll start with the northern part of our operational area. That would be Yankton. And first thing I want to say is this is a cooperative effort. The local officials that are working hard in those areas are to be commended. They are the first line of defense, and they're putting up a good fight with us, too. And to be specific, in Yankton, what happened is we've embedded our team with the Office of Emergency Management Type 3 team. We are working together and offering some help for those people that are tired on that team. And up in Yankton, we continue to, prisoners continue to build sandbags. And one big thing to be noted, which is I think very commendable, is yesterday, one of our folks, Laverne Hermanson, started an effort up there. He's was my branch director yesterday. Started an effort up there where houses were staked, and giving heights of where the homeowner could look at the stakes and see what they had to be above, and that was a good operation. As we move down the coast, we get to Vermilion. We are still evaluating that area. We move into North Sioux, and in North Sioux, we're working with the city and we're currently assessing their needs. They're taking the lead on a lot of this and working with them and providing their own support right now. Riverland has been evacuated, and at this point will be very difficult to defend. And that is a tragic situation there, and we're sorry for you folks that are there. As we move down the river, as we get down to Whinstone, there's a valiant effort going on at Whinstone right now. In Whinstone, the community is working very hard to defend their little community there. There was a little bit of misinformation that went out yesterday I'd like to correct, and a few folks in the news when we could help us, because when you help by sending out correct facts, one of the news agencies yesterday put out that the river would be 4 foot higher than anticipated, and that caused a lot of wide-scale problems for us as a management team at that point. So we need to be kind of, you know, on spot with our when we send out these facts. So to clear some of that up, Army Corps of Engineers says the river flows will stay static for the next 3 days. Next thing is that the target of 1098 has not changed. That has not changed when we've gone to 150 cubic feet per second. In addition to that, we've deployed Department of Transportation surveyors up to that area to take a look at those heights and make sure we have accurate maps so those homeowners will know what they have to build to. We are also supporting that operation with sandbags, both being flown in but with aerial operations and ground operations. And in addition to that, I just want to say it's a good joint effort at this time. Now let's take you to the one area that is the really fight is on right now, and we're I'm very confident, as much as I can be, let's say that we will win this battle here. Okay, and we made good progress on meeting our tactical objectives, and those being, number one, our goal was to protect this community and build a primary levee and protect the infrastructure. At this point, we're well on our way to doing well with that primary levee. To that end, we will assess it tonight, but I truly believe we're in good shape. Talking about 3 days from toward the weekend. On the weekend, the reason we talked about the evacuation, and it's been spoken to down there, is the water will rise to a point where it's starting to hit the outside of that levee. At that point, you have a high pressure situation on one side of the levee and a low pressure on the other. As that water rises on the levee, it creates a situation where we could have a potential levee break. When that breaks, it becomes a swift water event. And that is why, for the safety of the public, at this point, we have issued a mandatory or a recommended mandatory evacuation of the lower port called the Country Club area of the dunes. Secondary levee, you know, we always manage for our worst case disasters. At that point, when people have left, and by tonight at 11:59, we will soon start construction of a secondary levee. That secondary levee will start to cause traffic issues. We are still going to leave a entranceway of about 15 feet, so emergency response people can get in and out and things like that. Should the levee breach, that secondary levee will be in place to contain the rest of the water that would flow into that. That's the end of my report, and thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Once again, I'd like to introduce Governor Dennis Dugard.
Joe brought up a point that I'd like to develop further. It was a good point, and it's important for everyone to understand when we talk about river levels. Of course, the river falls as it moves downstream. The topography of the land declines, and that's, of course, why the river flows in that direction. So at one end of Dakota Dunes, the river will rise to a certain level. At the upstream end of Dakota Dunes, it will be slightly higher. And as you move upstream mile after mile after mile, the river level continues to be slightly higher at all stages of release. So at this stage of release, you've got a higher river elevation in terms of foot above sea level than you do at Dakota Dunes, but the adjacent land is also higher. So it is important to understand the level to which the river will rise at 150 CFM and the level at which you're concerned about a structure or property on the land adjacent. So first, one must understand the level to which the river will rise and the level on the adjacent land. So our surveyors, Joe's surveyors, the county, the Department of Transportation, private engineers are all over this river reach. They are working with local groups to help landowners understand in McCook Lake area, where's their property, where will the water rise. In Dakota Dunes, we're using that data to judge the elevation that we must attain with the levee. We're using that just as well in Fort Pierre and Pierre. So again, the important thing for those property owners who are concerned about their property, go to the state website, BeReadySD.com, as we have information available about water levels, and we're trying to make it more and more and more specific for more and more and more sites on the river. The first thing we did was gravitated to the largest communities to try and get from the core their evaluation. And it's not a simple arithmetic progression either, because of course, as you come to different parts of the river, there may be adjacent land that is flat surrounding the river. Further down the reach, you might have adjacent land that is very steep. So the river will spread out in some areas and not spread out in others. So the calculations are very difficult, and the Corps is doing their best to give us as much information as they can. And as we receive it, we're trying to get it out to the public as quickly as we can, as well as being on the ground as much as we can with them to explain it in person. I just wanted to let you know that Joe's team especially is working hard in that area, as are the local county emergency managers.
Thank you, Governor. At this time, I think we'll open it up to questions here in Dakota Dunes. We'll take a few questions here, and then we'll see if there are any questions on the phone. So folks here in the audience, media members, floor is open.
The question was about flood insurance. Under the federal flood insurance rules, if I have property I want to protect from flooding, I must book the insurance, and if there's a flood event within 30 days, I don't qualify. It's like the guy that's facing open heart surgery. You can't go buy life insurance without having a good physical before you get the insurance. Similarly, you can't foresee an imminent flood event within 30 days and get flood insurance. There is no ability of the federal FEMA officials to waive the 30-day limit. That's statutory. The question, though, is when does the 30 days begin and end? When is the flood event? Has the flood event occurred yet? That's the issue. Most of the time, you can tell when a flood event occurs pretty quickly because it occurs pretty quickly. In this case, you've foreseen this flooding because the Corps advised of it. And so that is being judged, I think, today. I think FEMA is getting together with the Corps, and they're making some judgment about that, and I'm hoping we have some better information to offer on that question the next day or two. Don, do you want to answer that? The question is about the McCook Lake and the levee or the outlet. Are you talking about the outlet on either side?
Right.
Yes. Don, do you want to talk about that, or you want me to I'll start. I'm aware that on the east side, there is an outlet structure with a pump that pumps water into the lake to help maintain the levels during dry area or dry years, and I believe that has been blocked, I'm told, but Don will tell you more. And we just spoke about it this morning.
Thank you, Governor. I'm Don Fuchs, the mayor of North Sioux City. Thank you for the opportunity. The question regarding the levee is the city is working as we speak and started yesterday morning to try to build up the levee in that area to get to the elevation that we need to. There may be some other concerns about other areas. We're going to go ahead and do everything we can to build and maintain the levee to the heights that need to be maintained to protect McCook Lake and North Sioux City from the water. So we're in the process of doing that right now. We think we can get it done, but again, Mother Nature, when she comes to call, it's hard to predict. So, and then to answer your question about the pipe coming from the river to the lake, we're in the process of getting that thing cut off and closed as we speak. So, anything else on that one? All right, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.
Questions from other media members?
That. Was curious if we had heard some rumors, and we want to clarify this as best we can, of course, that there was actually people pouring concrete into their sewers to block them, and then that was going to make them, you know, unusable for the future. How are you plugging those sewers? What methods are you using?
Those are some methods that are available to us. It would only be done in areas that we are in the evacuated areas and that we would have to go back after this event and redo so that it would be usable again. So the answer to your question is that is a method. It's an extreme method, but these are extreme times. So we're going to take every step we can to make sure that we can provide service to all operating areas of Dakota Dunes.
Mr. Dooley, I'd like to get an idea what's being done at the golf course. What kind of work's being done there? And, you know, kind of what kind of impact losing that being out of commission means for a community like Dakota Dunes, which was pretty much the springboard to development here in Dakota Dunes.
Well, obviously the golf course was and is and will be a big part of our community. The golf course provided us the best line of defense for this event. They realized without the levees, there's no golf course, so we will evaluate the future, but we have every intention to bringing Dakota Dunes back to where it was before, if not better. So,
Dakota Dunes wouldn't be Dakota Dunes without that golf course, right? And the country club as well.
That's where Dakota Dunes got its start, yeah. So,
if there are no other questions here in Dakota Dunes, okay, we have one more.
Is there any concern about groundwater? I mean, I guess a lot of residents have expressed concerns about where the actual level of the ground level kind of starts. If it starts in their basement, if it starts in their front door, where should they be worried about? And is groundwater going to be a big concern, even with the levees, if they stay in place?
We should expect, homeowners should expect in the Fort Pier area as well as the Dakota Dunes area that they will have groundwater issues. You can't have water surrounding a community that has soils that are so sandy as they are in these riverside communities and not expect the water to come from below. We'll be dewatering adjacent areas as much as possible. To some extent, we must recognize that hydraulic pressure from the outside, if not compensated by some on the inside, will actually make it more likely that the levee would not be as strong. So in some adjacent areas outside the levee, inside on the what would otherwise be the dry side of the levee, we may allow some groundwater to accumulate. And as that occurs, even without that occurring, I'm sure we'll have some homeowners that have water issues in the lower levels. And that is something that cannot be avoided.
One last question here in Dakota Dunes, and then we'll open up to the phone.
The only other question that I have is about the secondary levee, of course, that we've heard so much about. And is that going to be built behind the area that is being evacuated entirely? And then I've heard it's going to stretch from the first primary levee from side to side.
The primary levee is a perimeter levee around the entire Dakota Dunes perimeter. The secondary levee will follow Pinehurst on both east and west, and follow Monterey Trail. It'll be above those streets in the a green area above those streets. And so that's why, as we get into the evacuation surveys door to door, and we explain to the residents that that secondary levee that was announced yesterday, what that means to certain residents, all pretty much the country club residents, in terms of their ability to remain and still have access in case of an emergency escape. So I think as people understand the need to have a secondary protection and the degree to which that confines them, I think we'll have more and more people recognize the seriousness of the risk, even without it, and certainly the heightened risk with it to staying. At some point, it will be completely sealed. And in fact, the as Joe mentioned, the completion date is Tuesday. And we hope we can complete all these projects sooner.
Okay, are there any questions to media members on the phone?
Yeah, Governor, this is Pete Harriman at the Argus Leader. I know this is an ongoing event with accumulating costs, but do you have any insight at this point as to what this is ultimately going to cost the state, and can it be addressed with emergency and reserve funds, or is it going to require other budget action?
I can't evaluate that just yet. I do know that that is the very purpose for which emergency reserve funds should be maintained. During the vigorous budget discussions in the most recent legislative session, there were a number of proposals to utilize emergency reserve funds to perpetuate ongoing overspending, and I resisted that. And one of the prime reasons I resisted it, because I said those funds should be used for emergencies and unforeseen one-time costs. And that's exactly what we are seeing today. The degree to which the state and local governments will have to bear the cost of some of these protective measures or recovery measures, I think will be reduced to the extent that we've got disaster declarations for 30 counties in South Dakota, the three counties here, Clay, Union, and Yankton, where I am this day. Those have not been declared a disaster yet because they haven't sustained measurable damage that has been totaled and submitted. I'm confident that will occur. And when it does occur, we'll ask that those three counties be officially declared part of the major disaster. And as you know, in those cases, then FEMA covers the cost of up to 75% of the cost of restoration of public infrastructure. Local government covers the cost of 15%, and the state covers 10%. In the case of preventive measures, such as the levees, then when you have a declaration that we have, an emergency declaration where preventive measures are potentially covered, then it is an after-the-fact determination by FEMA whether the protective measures were or were not appropriate. And they judge that based upon the degree to which public infrastructure was involved in that asset which is protected. So if you have a preventive measure that the county or the state or a district undertakes to protect itself, and if it protects a lot of public infrastructure, streets, water, sewer, lift stations, pumping stations, libraries, public buildings, the more of that is protected by these preventive measures, the more likely that FEMA will approve it as an expenditure in which they will give significant help. To the degree that it contains mostly private property and does not protect a lot of public infrastructure, then the willingness of FEMA declines. FEMA does not generally reimburse private property damage. The last time, if I understand it right, the last time FEMA provided financial support to individuals for their personal loss was in 97. And when that does occur, whether it's in South Dakota or elsewhere, in 97 in South Dakota, but when you look at other states and South Dakota and look at history, the amount of money that FEMA has provided as individual assistance is quite modest in comparison to the kind of damages we're looking at. And by modest, I mean $2,000 to $3,000 to $4,000. So not a significant per person individual financial help. Again, the preventive measures that protect public infrastructure, I think to the degree that they protect a lot of public infrastructure, if they incidentally protect private, as these levies do, I believe we have a good case, and I will argue vigorously that where you have a mix and public infrastructure is clearly within that mix, that FEMA should approve this as an appropriate expenditure that is in part reimbursable by FEMA. But it's the kind of thing where the public body has to spend the money first without knowing. And I must say, the local officials here have had the courage to go forward, knowing that their citizens may be, whether it be local or state, their citizens may be responsible for the bill entirely without federal support. But South Dakotans are self-reliant, and we want our fair share, but we'll also take care of ourselves.
Any other questions from callers on the phone? Any other questions?
Governor? Kevin Wooster? Nathan, we have a few questions up here.
Yes, go ahead.
Kevin? Could I ask if the rules and the prohibition against going on to the levees is being followed universally? Are you having to make any arrests here at Dakota Dunes? And are you having any problems with people in restricted zones?
I'm not aware of any instances where we had trouble with the levees nor with restricted zones.
And can I also ask, Governor, are you confident, given some problems that we've had with modeling that didn't work out on river flows and river releases, that the estimates on the height or the depth of the water is going to be accurate when it comes to coming within a foot or two or 3 feet at the top of some of these levees? Are you confident that when we get an estimate that it's going to be, for example, at Fort Pier at 1436 at the highest and the levees at 1437 or 8, whatever it happens to be, are you confident that that's not going to, that those estimates are going to be quite precise?
I think it would be foolish to look at a situation of this scale and where this has never been experienced before. I think if you don't look at those numbers with some skepticism and a healthy dose of recognition that these are best estimates created by very intelligent people whose intentions are good, but who are dealing with an unprecedented water release in areas where the topography changes every time someone builds a building or a road, or erosion occurs after a large rainfall, or additional erosion occurs underwater because of a significant release height. There are lots of variables at play And I think, I don't know this, but I'm hopeful that the Corps has taken much of this into account and has in place some measure of safety. So I wouldn't say the word confident would be appropriate from any listener's perspective, but I think the numbers are the best we can get from those best able to judge them. And I would rather act upon best information than no information.
Governor Tony Mangan at KCCR, can you explain the maintenance of the levees at this point? I mean, you were talking about a plan that's being worked on. What kind of plan, what kind of maintenance, and how long do you think that maintenance is going to have to last to make sure that the sand, that the dikes last?
Well, I think the surveillance, I'll answer the second part first. We need to surveil and maintain the levees for at least 2 months. Yesterday, the Corps mentioned in their 5 p.m. Central teleconference the month August for the first time. And I think, Tony, you were on the line. So today is very early June, so I assume that means for the months of June and July at the least. So we need to surveil and maintain those levees to our best ability. How one does that? Again, that is the subject of plans that are being created right now. Our efforts have been primarily directed at constructing them as quickly as we could and expanding them to those communities where we could. And we're still working feverishly to help those people who see the water coming. In most cases, the levee maintenance issue may not arise until a week from now, as the CFM reaches its highest peak. That's not to say we couldn't have a maintenance issue tomorrow, because the water is up in Fort Pierre. But when you raise it 6 inches, it's one thing. When it raises a foot or two or even three, that's another thing. So the need to surveil and maintain will increase and then be sustained for at least 2 months. How it's maintained, we need to consult with those who understand levees and the river's reaction with levee structures. And so we're going to be talking to the Corps to get their advice, talking to other people who have experience constructing river levees and other river structures to see if we can understand the hydrology and the hydrologic action upon a clay levee or a sand levee with clay cover or one that has a plastic face, and all dependent upon how the levee was built, what the materials were. We're acting using multiple materials given the topography with which we have to deal. And so we're going to be doing it for 2 months, and how we'll do it will evolve as we learn from others who know more and as we experience it.
Charles, with Public Broadcasting, I'd like to ask the Corps, if I can, how is the river reacting so far? What have we learned from the rise this morning, and what do we know about that helping us understand what's going to happen next? Is it following the model so far?
I'll take a shot. This morning we've been monitoring the river gauges, in particular the tailwater elevations and the river gauge in between Pier and Fort Pier. And we're coming up with some, we're looking at the numbers to see how it's responding to these initial releases at 8, and then again, we'll look at them again tonight after they respond at after 1600. And we're going to try to, the best we can, come up with some predictions on what we think it's how it's going to react, just to keep people informed if they want to know that type of information. But absolutely, there's folks down in the EOC right now that are consistently and constantly looking at those river gauges so that we can get some confidence in the numbers that the models have shown as we go through this event.
Do
Do we know by chance how far it's come up since this morning, since we've hit that 7,500 at different points?
This morning when I took the river gauge at approximately 0645, we were at an elevation. I won't give the specific elevation, but we took it again at almost noon, and it had risen 19 hundredths of an inch at the Pier River, 19 hundredths of a foot, excuse me, at that time. So I think we still haven't reached steady state, and we're still rising. And we're monitoring those pretty closely.
The USGS river gauges that are posted online in real time, are those accurate too? Can you see the rise on those?
Absolutely, absolutely. If you get an opportunity to take a look at those, that can help you monitor it yourself if you'd like.
And what's, you mentioned the rate of increase through tomorrow, a 10K increase at 8 a.m. and a 10K increase again tomorrow at 4 p.m. plus 120 tomorrow afternoon, if I'm right. What happens then after that to the 7th? What's the breakdown?
Well, and I've asked our people down in Omaha that. I don't know if they're still going to split it and do the two 5,000 cubic feet per second increases, or if they're going to stay with the 10 at the 8 o'clock. I'm anxiously awaiting their information so we can pass that on.
And what tubes come on in what order out of the Stilling Basin in Ahwahnee? Do you know that?
There is no set order in any of the operation of those tunnels. The only operation is that tunnels 5 and 6, and those are the ones to the farthest west, are our regulating tunnels. So tunnels 1 through 4 are either all the way open or all the way closed. Tunnels 5 and 6, they take up that incremental difference between what we have to go on or above a full tunnel.
They each have a capacity of 25,000 CFS, is that right?
About 18.
Oh, 18, thank you.
18,000 CFS.
For the mayors, talk about evacuations. Do you have numbers of how many people have evacuated, and do you know how many people might still be staying in those areas at this point?
I don't have numbers. The police department is working as we speak to identify homes that are occupied or not occupied, and we'll have those numbers on an ongoing basis. I would say the majority of the folks have chose to leave their affected areas at this time in Pier.
Well, I don't have any particular numbers either, Tony, but we've estimated that 90% plus in those lower lying areas have moved out or made arrangements to live somewhere else.
90% of the impacted area?
Yes.
We should probably take one more question from somewhere and then wrap it up. Nathan, do you want to handle that?
Yeah, we can take one more question on the phone.
Okay, we've got one last question here in Dakota Dunes.
Jeff, this might be more directed towards you. It's kind of a two-part question. For people who are evacuating, I heard that they will be shutting off natural gas today, but what about electricity and water? Should people be taking their own measures to alert the electric company if they're going to be leaving? And then secondly, is there a concern about security? Because we've heard reports of I wouldn't say a looter quite yet, but someone was arrested yesterday, according to a report, for being in the dunes past the security break. Can you comment anything on that?
Well, in regards to your first question, and when you leave your home, we have put out information that you should turn your water off down by your water meter if you can, and then contact Mid-American Energy to let them know that you're gone. I believe they're doing some gas shutoffs right now, mainly because you don't use a lot of natural gas in the summertime. The answer to your second question in regard to security, I had not heard that report, but right now we have countless number of sheriff's deputies, police officers, highway patrol, National Guard, so it may be one of the securest places around right now. And after, like I said in my earlier statement, after we get the levees built, after this has stabilized, I want to assure the people that are leaving the evacuation zone and can't get back in that we will work with the state and whoever we have to make sure that that area is secure from that type of activity.
Thank you, Jeff, and thank you to the folks on the call and in the audience. I think that'll wrap it up for today. Dakota Dunes, and we're off.